Menlo Park, and we'll be moving back there after graduating. We're back that direction to work for a company in San Francisco called MuleSoft, with the software. She's always liked math, but her decision to major in math came after taking Linear with Shariari, and loved the math community, and then went on to also really like mentoring for some classes. For intro to analysis, she really liked, and that was kind of one of her favorite moments in the community. So here goes Ashley.
And I'm really excited to be able to present to you today on topic modeling, which is a really exciting field in machine learning, and particularly how I've applied it to studying the New York Times in the World War II period. So before we get started, I just want to do a brief outline of what I'm going to be covering in my presentation. First, I want to motivate why this is an exciting field of study and why it's important nowadays. Moving on to study latent Dirichlet allocation, which is the primary topic model that I chose to study in my thesis. Hopefully that will transition rather seamlessly into studying Gibbs sampling, which is the way that we actually approximate the variables in which we're interested in, and then conclude by showing you some of the results of my own topic modeling adventure. So, as you know, we're living in an age of increasing digitization. There are more and more videos, blogs, documents, all of these sorts of things being put online. And they're ways of searching by a keyword or URL, but we want to find new ways to search through these collections and maybe annotate them by the topics that are in them. Let's say you're interested in a particular topic and you want to see how it's changed over time. Well, that's what leads us to probabilistic topic modeling. And these are a class of computer algorithms and statistical methods that allow us to go through a corpus or a collection of lots of documents and group these words into topics or themes. So as I mentioned, I particularly studied LDA, or latent Dirichlet allocation. And before I go into more of the model, I want to give you an example of what maybe the outputs might be from this. So let's say you have these five sentences. And we're going to treat these sentences like they are our corpus, and each one is a particular document. So what does LDA tell us? Well, it's telling us that in sentences one and two, we see these words like avocados, raspberries, mango, things of this sort, and we see it's all about one particular topic. We look at sentences three and four, we see it's also all about one topic, this topic in blue, but it's about a different topic. And we look at this final sentence, and we see it's made up of a combination of topics. So this is one output that LDA is going to give us, is looking at the documents and seeing what topics make them up. The second output it's going to give us is we can look more specifically at each of these topics. Let's say topic A in red here, and we see it's made up of, you know, the words raspberries, smoothies, mango, and this LDA isn't smart enough to tell us what this topic is and give it a name, but it's up to us to look at the words and say, you know, we can probably infer this topic's about food, and we can do something similar to infer that the other topic is maybe about challenging math. So now let's define this a bit more. So LDA is one type of topic model, and it is based on the assumption that documents are just a mixture of multiple topics, and that each document was generated in a specific manner. And it's the way that it was generated is what really defines what LDA is, and I'm going to get into that in a minute. But let's go through a couple of model assumptions first. First, we assume we have a set of D documents, and these D documents form our corpus. Next, the number of topics K is decided upon in advance. So before we begin the topic modeling, we choose how many topics we want to extract from our model, from our corpus. Next, that each document is what's called a bag of words, which means that the ordered words don't matter, and neither does the grammatical structure. And this is what allows us to eliminate all stop words. So things like a, the, he, she, things that don't contribute to thematic meaning, we can eliminate them, and we're left with N words in each document D, where N is going to differ for each document. So now let's go to how LDA assumes that each document was generated. Now, you and I know that each author, when they're going in and writing a document, they have a particular motive in mind when they're writing it, and they don't generate it by this probabilistic structure. But LDA assumes that it was generated in this way. Let's say we have K topics that we've chosen, and each one of these is going to be represented by a different color. Now we're going to look at a document level, and it's going to assume that a document was generated in this particular manner. First, we're going to randomly choose a distribution over the topics. So we have these K topics, but for this particular document, we might have this distribution given by this histogram on the right, where it seems like, you know, the topic in yellow might be more prevalent for this document. Now, for each word, we're going to randomly choose a topic from this distribution over topic. And these, let's say I want you're going to randomly choose a word from this topic, because all the topic is just a distribution over words. And the LDA assumes that every single word in this document was generated by this particular process. Now let's define this generative process a bit more formally. Let's say we have our fees, 1 through k. These are going to be our k topics. We have our thetas, d of k, where this is just the proportion, the topic proportion for topic k in document d. And this was given by our histogram on the last slide. Next, we have our z's, and these are just the topic assignments for each particular word. And these were those coins or circles. And finally, we have our words. And after defining all of these, we're able to generate or to produce this joint distribution over these four variables. We see the joint distribution where we look at the probability over these four variables can just be defined in this manner, and we can walk through each part. It's just going to be the probability over all of our topics, so over all our fees, 1 through k, multiplied by the probability of all of the topic proportions over all of our documents. And then we're going to look at more of a word level, and we're going to multiply this by all of our topic assignments. And we see we have a dependency here, where the topic assignment, remember that was the coin, depended on the distribution, or the topic proportions, our thetas. And we're going to multiply this by the probability of our words. And we see another dependency here, where the words are going to depend on which topics or fees we have in our model, and also on our ZDNs, which are the topic assignments, so what the topic the word came from. Now, this is all great. However, in reality, we don't know what the topics are that generated these words. All we have are the words. And so because we can only determine these words, we really want to reverse this generative process to actually figure out what the hidden semantic structure is and what are these latent variables. So as you can see, on the left-hand side, we have this generative process that I described before, where we have these particular topics, and we know what they are, and we know with what probabilities they've generated these given words. But in reality, we're actually on the right-hand side over here, where we have to do some statistical inference, because what we have are these words, and we don't know the topics that generated them, or with what proportions, and that's what we want to figure out. So that's what leads us. We again have this joint distribution, but it leads us to our posterior equation. So as I said, we know what the words are, so we want to condition on our known variable and try to figure out these other three variables, our fees, our thetas, and our z. And we're left with this posterior equation. And we can apply Bayes' rule, and we know that our numerator is just going to be the joint distribution that we already have before, and then we're going to divide it by the probabilities over all the words over all the documents. Now this is great. However, it turns out that this denominator cannot actually be computed exactly. And so because of this, we need to find a way to approximate this distribution. And that's what leads to Gibbs sampling, which is the next topic. So Gibbs sampling is a type of Markov chain Monte Carlo, and I'll briefly define what that is in a moment. But it's what allows us to extract these topics from our corpus. And what it's doing is it's approximating our desired distribution, this distribution of the posterior equation that we just saw. And after the end of it, we're going to be left with estimates for our fees, our thetas, and our z's. So now briefly, what's Markov chain Monte Carlo? Which is kind of hard to explain in one short definition. But Markov chain Monte Carlo is what allows us to sample values from complex distributions. For example, that posterior distribution that we couldn't approximate, that we couldn't simulate exactly. And each successive random selection is going to form a Markov chain. And what's unique about this is the steady state distribution of this Markov chain will be our desired distribution, of the distribution of our posterior equation. And so that's what's going to allow us to approximate that equation. But as I mentioned, we're now going to walk through a little bit of what Gibbs sampling is going to do. So let's say we want to sample x from our distribution, probability over x. Now what is Gibbs sampling doing? Well, first of all, we're going to randomly initialize each xi. And it doesn't matter what value we give it at the start, it's just a baseline, and we're going to improve upon it from there on each successive iteration. So first of all, we're going to go through each iteration, and we're going to sample x1, and we're going to base its new value by looking at the values of all of the other variables in which we're interested in, and we're going to update that. Likewise, x2, we're going to base it off of the values of all the other variables. However, we're going to also base it off our new value from x1 that we just got, all the way through until we get to xn. And as you can see, we're now updating xn based on the values for x1 through xn minus 1 that we just computed for this iteration. And we're going to step through this until all of our samples converge to our desired distribution, which is this posterior distribution. now, something that's unique is that we want estimates of these three variables, and we could solve for them by the previous method. However, something you'll have to trust me on because there's not enough time to drive, but phi and theta are conjugate priors. And what this means for the purpose of what we're trying to do is that we can actually integrate them out of our joint distribution that we already have. And after we do that, we're just left with this distribution where we're looking at the probability over our z's and our w's, and we no longer have these other two variables. So we call this our collapsed skew sampler because we've essentially collapsed a few variables out of it. And it's going to be a faster way to figure out what our z's are. And so this collapsed skew sampler is going to allow us to calculate the probability that this topic zi was assigned to a given word wi based on all the other topic assignments. So this z minus I, it refers to the topic assignment, all the other topic assignments besides the one at which you're looking. And it turns out that then we can actually define phi and theta in terms of z, and so that's how we're going to be able to calculate those in the end. So I know that's a bit of a brief and quick overview for GIF sampling, but I just wanted to give you some background on that. But I wanted to take the time to talk more about how I've been able to apply topic modeling in my particular research. So the reason I was initially drawn to topic modeling is I wanted to find an area of study that combined the three things that I'm studying here, which are math, computer science, and history. And topic modeling is being used more and more in the digital humanities as historians are trying to find ways to quantify their research. And so I am particularly interested in World War II, and I knew I wanted to study that time period. And so I was, of course, limited because I needed to be topic modeling English texts, and also they had to be in the form of text files. And so I decided to turn to the New York Times and to topic model the front page articles from the New York Times from January 1st, 1939, until December 31st, 1945, which are the complete years of World War II, even though the US hadn't entered right at the beginning. And although for the purposes of this presentation, because some of this code, for example, just took 6 days to run, I'm only presenting results just on 1941 instead of the full time period. So there are great things that come from studying an original data set, and this, I'm looking at something that people haven't looked at in this manner before through topic modeling. But there are also a lot of complications that arise. And I'm going to go through briefly what some of those are. First of all, I was looking at about 33,000 different articles. But these are all saved in the form of images based on the time period. They weren't digitized, or at least some text files. And they're all saved as separate PDFs in the Times Machine, which is the archive of the New York Times. And so I had to find a way to automatically download all of these, but also to convert them into text files, because you can't run a topic modeling algorithm on PDF or on an image. And so that led to running optical character recognition, which converted them into text files. However, it introduced its whole new host of issues. For example, words that might be split across two lines, like attacking here, this is what the article would have actually looked like. The OCR in the text file, the words continue to be split over these two lines. So there's a lot of data cleaning, like putting these words back together. It introduces a lot of typos, so cleaning these up, eliminating words that don't pertain to thematic meaning, like continued on page such and such, which isn't really important for studying the topics. And so it turns out that the most arduous part of the task is this data pre-processing and getting it ready to topic model. But that leads to moving into R and trying to do some last minute cleaning before starting the topic modeling process. And I'm not going to touch on all of these, but the one I want to focus on in particular is stemming words. And so if we have these words in particular, argues, we see they all really have the same root, the stem of argue. And they're all going to contribute to these topics in the same way. And so we don't actually want to treat them as separate words. And so there's a package in R where you can go through and stem each of the words. And so I only bring this up because as you start seeing some of the results, some of the words might look kind of funky. And that's because they're the stems of the actual words. So now going into the actual topic model. As I mentioned at the beginning, that one of the important tasks up front is choosing the optimal number of topics that you want to extract from your corpus. And so there are many ways of going about doing this, and there have been papers written on this. R has this LDA tuning package, which is based on three particular metrics. And I won't go into what they are, but we see these top two. We want to find the number of topics that's going to minimize these metrics. And the bottom one, we want to find the number of topics in the corpus that's going to maximize. Now this is the code that just took 6 days to run because it's going to fit a model for each number of these topics and then compute the metrics. But we see for my 1941 data, it seems to suggest somewhere around 160 to 200 topics is about the optimal number. So after you have that, you can run some cross-validation. It's based on the perplexity, which is the inverse of log likelihood of your data, to try to narrow it in more. But in reality, it's going to come down to trial and error, because what topic modeling is at its core is you need to have an understanding of the domain knowledge, and you figure out from the output what's really going to be optimal for your data. So you need to look at it and figure out how granular do you want your topics to be. And so I chose 180 topics for this particular data set. And so these are some of the results. And we see these are the top 10 most frequently occurring topics across this 1941 data, and then within each one, the top 10 most frequently used words within this particular topic. And so as I said at the beginning, LDA isn't going to tell you what the topic is. It's going to tell you what words comprise the topic. And so you can look at them, like topic one, and say, you know, we have bomb, German, air, British, things like this. And we might begin to deduce this is probably about the aerial raids happening. And in fact, this was one of the years of the Blitz. And we can go on and do this for the subsequent topics as well for all 180. But something else I wanted to draw your attention to are we see words like German and British occurring across many of these topics. And in fact, these two words are the words that occur most frequently across the whole corpus. But we see that the model is taking into consideration the context. And for example, British in topic one, as we talked about the aerial raids, is going to be very different than the British that's talked about in topic six, where it's actually talking about a campaign in Libya. So it takes that into consideration. So now let's take a look at topics 9 and topic 10. And as you first look at them, you see Japan and Japanese at the top, and you might start to think these are similar topics. And so this is where the fine-tuning of the model comes in, where you're trying to figure out what the optimal number is, and maybe you want to combine them into a similar topic. But in the reality here, if you look more deeply at some of the other words that make them up, we see that topic 9 is more about the relationship of the colonies in the Indochina Sea, and topic 10 is more about the politics happening in these countries. Now, something else that was really interesting about this is that as we look at the top 10 most prevalent topics, and just the whole number, all 180 in general, is that most of them in this particular year are about international relations and the war effort, and very few are about domestic issues and what's happening on the home front within the United States. And so this is one exception. We have here, you know, union strikes. Turns out 1941 was a year when there were a lot of strikes and disruption in the workplace, and so we got to see that. But one thing that was interesting is throughout this particular year, it seemed that more emphasis was placed externally on what's happening internationally. But that's one thing I'm going to be looking at as I study the full model, is how that might change over the year. So there are many different ways that one can then present the results and look at them. And I've only just started to continue to do this, but one way that's a visual way of looking at it are creating word clouds. And I've created one for each of the topics, and it's just a fun visual way of looking at this. And we see the words that are in darker green and are bigger are the words that occur more frequently within this topic. So for example, this is the topic that we've seen before. We see words like bomb, German, British occur quite frequently and are bigger. But it's the smaller words that start to round out our topic, like the countries or the cities where these bombings occurred, things of that sort. So it's a nice way to be able to visualize each of your topics and glean more from them. So with that in mind, as I continue to move forward, I'm going to be continuing to fine-tune and fix this model, study some of the results. But in reality, it will be moving into studying the full corpus, which I'm hoping won't take 6 days times seven in order to complete, and topic modeling these 7 years of the war and trying to figure out how these trends evolve over time, as you know, maybe there's more emphasis on a particular on politics or on economics or a particular front of the war. And so that's what's going to be what really interesting about these particular results. So with that, any questions? Over two lines, and then in terms of the spell check and autocorrect, I use some Python packages that are already pre-made that go through and first check if a word's misspelled and then try to find ways to fix it. And then a lot of it is trying to understand your own documents, and so a lot of time looking at what the text files were and things that I wanted to eliminate. published on or copyright or things that would occur across a lot of documents and find those words, and then it's some trial and error of trying to figure out which more, sort of the words you want to add to that list to start removing. Yeah.
So when you're looking at how topics have evolved, is there a standard kind of statistical way to do that, or like modeling way to do that, or are you just kind of like look at it yourself and kind of assess that?
So I haven't gotten there yet, so I can't tell you fully, but it particularly will be, there are different plots you can generate, so you can see in particular years what the primary topics are, especially when you've labeled them, and you can start to see as it evolves, you look at a particular year and see, you know, what the prevalent topics were, and then you can particularly zoom in on particular topics after you've labeled them and figure out how they might change over those particular years. Yeah. I'll know more soon. Yeah, Robin.
Is there a way, like, say you go through and you see two topics that you decide, okay, these two topics are actually the same topic, we don't want these two to be separate anymore. Is there a way to, like, once you have a model, then fine-tune it and say, okay, can you please combine these two topics into one topic? Or is it more so that you have to regenerate it with a smaller number of topics?
You have to regenerate with a smaller number of topics. You can't fine-tune it so that you specifically make these the same topic. Yeah. Either one of you.
I'm curious about how do you use the three metrics to determine, like, what's the optimal number of topics that you should choose?
Yeah. So they're based on different things. And I can't really get into exactly what each one's based on, but one's more of a Bayesian model. One talks about the Keebler, I forget exactly, like KL divergence, which is based on information gain. So each one's based off of something different. You see they've been normalized here. And we know that we want, for the Griffiths one, for example, the metrics that it spits out, we're trying to maximize that metric. And so we look to see where it's going to be maximized. And for the other two, the metric we're interested in is one that we want to minimize. And so we see where the number of topics is going to minimize that. And we might look at a particular range. And then from that, it's going to be a lot of fine tuning of the model by fitting it for different ones and seeing what the outputs are. James?
What does it mean to initialize the values? Like, you're talking about doing a Gibbs sampler.
Right.
What does it mean to initialize topics? Like I understand if it's like a number or something, but do you just like put in specific words into the topics and then it?
So, for example, for disease, these are topic assignments, and that's a very good question.
Okay.
I would have to think about that more, but you can. I'd have to think about it and get
like
back
maybe
to
you just like assign a word to a random topic.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. So the ZIs are going to be that the probability that ZI is being assigned to this word in the topic assignment. So it's gonna come from that. Yeah. I have to think about that more. That's a good question.
I have a specific question about like the package that generates the stems or
whatever
words. Because I noticed in like topic 9,
which is
all the topics.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's particularly looking at, finish your question.
Yeah, so I'm like, how would that like package differentiate between like words that like mean completely different things, like pacifist versus like pacific?
Yeah, it will differentiate between those. There's some room for error, I will admit. And also, you'll see words like French and France that might have similar meaning because they're different stems. They're going to show up as different words, but also we see, I have an example of this, things like ER words, like fighter, it doesn't stem to fight. It's stemming primarily ing words and ed words and things of that sort. So it's not going to stem everything perfectly, but it is a way to limit it down the number of words at which you're looking.
Just a minor question. So topic 2, is that when the Siege of Leningrad was?
Yes.
1941?
Yeah. It was starting in early 1941. I actually first had a timeline, a brief intro, because I really like the history. I eliminated from it because it wasn't very mathy, but it 1941 at the start is when the Nazis decided to invade, break the peace pact with the Soviet Union and invade. And towards the end of it is when they've done the siege of Leningrad around the time of end of 1941, and by the end they're breached